Geotalk. It's the honors students today. They're telling us about their honors field trip that happened back in June. I guess I don't need to say anything more in terms of introduction. There's 8 of them presenting, so I guess I don't need to introduce them one by one. They'll do that as they go along.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Today, as the Geology Honours class, we'll be just giving you a brief outline of our field trip that we took to Barberton, amongst other places, as well as the mine visits that we just had recently. Today, our speakers will be Yvonne, Lemogang, please wave, Sena, Pumi, Marilee, and Kulegani at the back. So please sit back and enjoy. Thank you.
And her name is Ayanda. I'm going to take you through the TTG suites of the Barberton Greenstone Belt, which were the first locality that we visited. So to start things off, I'm going to first explain to you what TTGs are. So they're rocks that form from... they originate from partial melts of either amphibolites or hydrated basalt in the garnet stability field. And in the Barberton Greenstone Belt, this is where the TTGs are found. So you have the Nalshoogte, the Kapvelitonalite, the Budplas, and the Stolzberg, the Thiesspruit, and then here we have our Barberton Greenstone Belt. So just in terms of the mineralogy, the TTG suites are composed principally of... The TTG suites are composed principally of quartz and plagioclase, and they've got minor alkali feldspar, and they are sodic. So this is the Nalshoogte tonalite, which was the first one that we saw. This is amongst the youngest... TTG suite that you find in the Barberton area. And according to an article by Moyen, which he published in 2007 on the TTG suites in the Barberton area, 5 phases of the TTG suites were mapped in Barberton, 2 of which were trondhjemite and 3 of which were tonalite. This next one shows the Nalshoogte trondhjemite. And I want you to focus on this image. So these are an echelon sigmoidal veins. And what we concluded in the field was that they basically showed us the direction of displacement. And we concluded that it was dextral. And on this image, what you can see is broken up fragments of rock inside a melt, which we concluded by saying that when the Nalshoogte trondhjemite intruded into the country rock, it intruded into something that was already solid, causing there to be a lot of broken up fragments of the rock. And this is just in continuation. So during our structural geology lecture earlier this year, we learned the term anatexis. So basically what it entails is when 2 phases separate. So you have a lighter phase and a darker phase, and it can be seen as well in this image, and we were exposed to that on the field, so it was good to see something that we had done during lectures. And unfortunately, we weren't able to see outcrops of the other TTG suites, but I'll just explain what they are. We've got the Steenstorp. The Steenstorp is the oldest pluton that is found in the Barberton area. Its age is 3.55 to 3.5 billion years, and it is mostly tonalitic. Then we've got the Stolzberg and the Thiesspruit. They intruded at 3.45 billion years. Then we've got the Budplas, which intruded at 3.29 to 3.24 billion years. And it is mainly trondhjemitic. And then lastly, we've got the Cup Valley tonalite, which is the youngest. And how we saw this on the field was, so there's like this road, it's called, there's a devil's claw, so it's like a peak, and we had to stand and look over the Cup Valley tonalite because it wasn't really safe for us to go down there. So its age is 3.2 billion years. And according to an article by Moyen in 2007, he concluded that the TTG suites in the Barberton area were actually NYSIC. This is because during the time that they were being emplaced, they were simultaneously deformed. So right now I will call on Pumi, who will take you through the rest of the Barberton. Thank you.
Greetings to you all. I am Pumi, as she mentioned, and I'll be telling you about the next part of our field trip. Okay, so we're looking at a simplified geological map of the Barberton Greenstone Belt, which I'm proud to tell you is now a World Heritage Site because of its geological merit. And so I should probably mention that we went to Barberton on the 4th of June, and a few weeks later then it was declared a World Heritage Site. I think we were the missing ingredient. Okay, so just to say, we're looking at this, the plutons that Yvonne mentioned, and they are surrounding the Barberton Greenstone Belt. And so I will go further into the stratigraphy in the next few slides. You've probably heard of Barberton already before, from first year all the way to post-grad, because of the famous discovery by Wits alumni, the Falloon brothers, in 1969. And next year is actually going to be the 50th anniversary of that discovery. So many people know Barberton because of that. And so it's basically because of the significance of the texture that you see on the screen. This is spinifex komatiite. It's because of the quench texture that you see as a result of very hot magmas being extruded underwater. Okay, so the temperature associated with them is 1,600 degrees Celsius. That's quite hot compared to current volcanics. You've probably also heard about Barberton because of pillar lavas. We've got the best preserved pillar lavas in southern Africa, which is part of the reason why it got World Heritage status. And also, it is a good place to go and see the earliest forms of life that are visible to the naked eye, basically telling you about the evolution of bacteria and how they started colonizing terrestrial parts of the Greenstone Belt. Okay, moving on. So during our field trip, the economic deposits that we saw include gold from the Sheba mine, talc from the Scotia mine, and along the GeoTrail, which is a geotourism product linking Barberton with Swaziland, we saw a bit of banded iron formation. And from a distance, we saw historical mines that used to produce hematite and chrysotile asbestos. And then on our last day, going outside of Barberton towards Cap Maiden, on a roadside, we then saw magnesite veins, which I'll tell you more about in the next few slides. So the background geology. The Barberton supergroup, formerly known as the Swaziland supergroup, consists of three stratigraphic units. The oldest one being the Onverwacht group, mainly consisting of ultramafics and mafics, minor felsic volcanics and tuffs, and here and there you find thin layers of chert. Older than that, or younger than that, is the Fig Tree group, which is mainly marine siliciclastics and some chemical sediments. And then overlying that is the Moody's group, which is the youngest of them all, mainly siliciclastics, lots of quartzites and conglomerates. Provenance are the underlying Barberton supergroup units, as well as the surrounding plutons. Okay, so the tectonic setting. If you are someone who believes in tectonic, tectonics happening during the Archean, before three billion years ago, then this is the model we will go with. The volcanic arc will be the oldest units, the Onverwacht group. The back arc basin will be parts of the Fig Tree, and then the fallen basin will be the Moody's. Just to zoom into Moody's time deposition, it starts off with an extensional tectonic regime, and then halfway into Moody's time, then you start getting a compressional regime, which then, according to this model, produces reactivation of normal faults. So you end up getting a high angle reverse fault, which will be significant for mineralization. All right? Okay, so this is just zooming in into the Moody's group being one of the main ore deposits that we saw. What we're looking at here, the lower part of the Moody's stratigraphy is just the extensional regime. And then just up to here where you see the squiggly line is an angular unconformity best expressed in saddleback syncline. Basically, it marks the onset of compressional regime and tells you about basin shortening. From then onwards, you start getting upward coarsening sequences. All right, so mineralization. We know from the oil and gas industry that you need a source, you need a transport, and you need some kind of a trap. If we borrow this model and apply it to the deposits that we saw in Barberton, if we start off with gold at Sheba Mine, you have to have a source for your metals, and according to literature, that source may have been the Ontvervaart group, because it has been calculated that you would need about 10 cubic kilometers of lava to generate the Barberton Greenstone Belt gold. In Barberton, we have 4,800 cubic kilometers of lava, which means it's a likely source. Fluids to actually leach out, I know it's not on the slide, but the fluids for that are said to have come from metamorphic reactions where you produce water as a byproduct. And so this is just to show you that the lowermost group, the Ontvervaart, is more than half of the thickness of the whole Barberton stratigraphy. So it's a good source, it's a good option for supplying metals, all right? And then the mineralizing fluids, as I've mentioned, were metamorphic fluids. Because of fractures that have formed during the extensional as well as the compressional regime, they served as conduits for these metamorphic fluids containing metals to travel through. And what we find is the major mineralization in the Barberton Greenstone Belt occurs along fracture zones, and the best ones are where the fractures actually intersect. A good example of that, you have the fluids and the metals, now you need a trap, you need to cause deposition. One of the main things you can do to get a fluid to precipitate economic minerals is to change the pressure. If you go from high pressure to low pressure, then you can start precipitation. Or if you encounter a redox boundary, which in our field trip at Sheba Mine, we actually found pieces of graphite or kerogen, which might tell you about a redox change between reduced and oxidized environments, and that kind of transition could cause mineralization. And this is a cross-section of Sheba Mine. To the north is the Sheba Fault, basically with vein-hosted gold deposits. Most of them are native. And to the south, you have more of the refractory gold. Basically, it's sulfide-hosted gold deposits that are now commonly mined in the area. Previously, there was a lot of the visible gold being pursued by many prospectors. And this that you're looking at is a huge man-made cave. Basically, it used to be a shear zone that was very mineralized. And they dug out all the economic ore, and now it's just a hollow place used for geotourism. The reason that it's significant is because it has the richest concentrations of gold known in the area. Apparently, the first 50 tons produced had an exceptional grade of 250 grams per ton. To compare that with the present day production, they have only about 10 to 12 grams per ton. The ore body that they were mining out was just a stockwork of quartz carbonate veins hosting gold, and it used to continue to depth. It was 300 meters long. Okay, so this is just a picture that we got to, a sample that we got to see while we were at Sheba Mine, and we were told that they are now mining at a level of about 2 kilometers deep. All right, and then we went now to the geotrail for a bit of geotourism. Basically, this is a good summary place to tell you about the significance of the Barberton Greenstone Belt because, number one, the rocks are just next to the road, so accessibility is great. And also for people who don't have time to go through the southern part, the western part, and all of parts of the BGP, then this is a good place to go to learn the geology. The geotrail links Barberton here up to the top left of the picture. And it goes south all the way towards the northwestern border of Swaziland. And so that's where we went. This is the first stop. We were going towards a road cut looking for volcanic lapilli. Basically what this is, it's you know, when you get volcanism and you have tuff in the air, then it coalesces and it rolls down like hail. So these are just, you can think of them as volcanic hailstones. And you can see that, I don't know, from they have a central part and they grow out outwards. Okay, so that's what we're looking for. It's in a unit in the Onverwacht group. Basically, the cherty horizons mark gaps in eruptive cycles. And then here we have good honors students discussing the different theories of how this chert conglomerate might have come about. There were ideas about it being a tsunami conglomerate. Basically, it's a poorly sorted, very, they call it a conglomerate. It's more like a breccia with very elongate chert slabs that are highly angular. So we had a good discussion about how that came to be. And then we walked along the geotrail looking at the structural fabric of the Barberton Greenstone Belt from the south towards the northern part, all the way towards Barberton. Okay, so the ore deposits that we saw along the geotrail is a banded iron formation mainly containing hematite and an iron hydroxide guthite. And then some minor magnetite, which we were now told is not very, it's not an economic deposit because it has minor magnetite. And the hematite is also in a bad condition. And so you'll notice that this iron formation predates the great oxygenation event that is about 2.45 billion years ago. And so there's a lot of theories about how this came to be. Right now, my favorite one is the organic one, which involves basically bacteria that can oxidize iron and produce oxygen as a byproduct. And unfortunately for them, then they get coatings of iron 3 oxide, and then as they die and settle down, then you get thicker successions of banded iron formation. There are other models that basically say that the oxygen might have come from photolytic breakdown of ozone in the upper atmosphere. That's a possibility. So the other iron-related deposit that we saw from a distance was the famous Ngwenya mine. It's known for its red ochre, which has been used as far back as 43,000 BC. So it's mainly used by traditional healers. You've seen people with red clay in their hair. That's where some of the people get that. It's also associated with Bushman paintings. Okay. Moving on, we also saw a bit of Onverwacht mineralization in the form of hydrothermal deposits. And so that, depending on what kind of hydrothermal fluid you get, you will get a different product coming from that. And so we have variants of hydrothermal deposits from Onverwacht ultramafics. These include talc, magnesite, and asbestos. I'm going to talk about talc for now. So the talc mineralization that we saw in Barberton came from the serpentinization of ultramafics and mafics of the Onverwacht group. Now, if you then further alter that serpentinite, you are doing a process called steatization. Okay, that basically means you're taking that serpentinite and you're forming talc from it. You can get different versions of talc depending on the fluid that you get. If the fluid is just silica rich, then you produce pure talc, which is locally known as the super white. Our guide was actually very excited to show us this because it's a high quality product, mostly used for cosmetics. And then if your fluid is both silica rich and carbon dioxide rich, then you produce a lower grade version of talc, and that is a talc carbonate. So you typically find this kind of deposits near shear zones where hydrothermal fluids can come through, or you find them near intrusions, okay? So this is a group of empowered students who have just mastered the geology of talc deposits. And then the last deposit I'm going to tell you about also includes Onverwacht mafics and ultramafics. It's a magnesite deposit found along... I see someone recognizes themselves. It's a magnesite deposit found along the road that links Barberton to Malelane. You might know Malelane for the Kruger National Park. Okay, so this is occurring in a magnesite field. Basically, you have the mafics and ultramafics of the Onverwacht group. Wherever they were fractured, if a hydrothermal fluid that contains carbon dioxide comes through, then it causes alteration. And that alteration, if you then, since that fluid is going through a mafic rock rich in magnesium, then that carbon dioxide reacts with that magnesium to form a magnesium carbonate called magnesite. And you'll see here behind Senamile that we have a vein network full of white veins. Those veins are the magnesium carbonate. All right, so as I've mentioned, it's an olivine, it's a mafic olivine-rich peridotite, which supplied the magnesium. And then the fluids were full of carbon dioxide, and then they formed the carbonate. So these deposits are typically 30 meters deep is the lowest depth that you can get. And they commonly occur in the northeastern parts of the Barberton Belt, quite close to the major shear zones. All right, so at the end of this trip, all of us got a little bit more famous because the local paper in Barberton decided to feature us. So yeah, that was great. I'm going to pass on now to Senamile.
Okay, good afternoon. Well, after being exposed to one of the world's oldest rocks in the Barberton, we just had to go and see the Bushveld complex. So we went to the Eastern Mpumalanga. But firstly, we were exposed to the rocks of the Transvaal Supergroup, which actually developed in the Carbonate Crate Zone during the period of 2.65 to 2.5 billion years. It actually formed by extensional tectonics, which was actually the rifting of the under the Ventersdorp supergroup lavas, and then the basin formation, and then the Transvaal supergroup was actually deposited there. Well, it comprises three sequences: the older Black Reef formation, which comprises shales and conglomerates; the Chinasport group, which comprises Malmali dolomites and banded iron formations; and the Pretoria group, which comprises sandstones and shales, yeah. So in our full trip, we're actually exposed to the rocks of the Chinasport group. We actually saw the Malmali group dolomites, where we actually saw these large stromatolites. And we also learned that mineralization associated with these dolomites is actually gold, which was remobilized by hydrothermal fluids during the deposition, during the intrusion of the Bushveld complex. And also associated with the Transvaal supergroup, the other deposits in this group include base metals, which are Mississippi type valley deposits, lead, zinc, fluoride deposits in the Chinaspot group, iron in the Pangaea formation, the redox mineralization controlled manganese deposits in the Gagamara and Hottis Hall formation, and metamorphic ores, asbestos, and andalusites. We then went to the Bushveld complex, which is the world's largest layered mafic intrusion, which was in South Africa at approximately 2.06 billion years. It comprises these four different components, but then the rocks that we were exposed to were the rocks of the Rustenburg layered suit, which is the 7 to 9 kilometer thick succession, which is the host to the largest known platinum group metals, chromium and vanadium deposits. It is exposed as a series of limbs, the western, the eastern, the southern, and the northern limbs. And then each limb comprises five different stratigraphic zones, starting with the lower marginal zone, which comprises norite, the lower zone, which comprises orthopyroxenite, danite, and hasbergite, the critical zone, which comprises pyroxenite and anorthosites, the main zone, which comprises gabbronorite and anorthosites, and the upper zone, which comprises anorthosites and gabbros. So during our field trip, we actually got to saw rocks of the upper zone and the critical zone. So Marilee will take you through what we actually saw in the critical zone. Thank you.
So now we are at the second national heritage site. So the Dwars River heritage site, this place is recognized as a heritage site because we have well exposure of the mysterious spectacular chromatite anorthosite igneous layering. So this place, Dwars River, it's along the Stilbord fault and close to the main zone and critical zone boundary. Okay, so stratigraphically, the Dwars River, it's in the upper zone of the critical zone. It's in the upper critical zone. So the chromatite layers in the critical zones are clustered into three groups. We have the lower group chromatites, the middle group chromatites, and the upper group chromatites. So this place, it's at the location of the upper group one chromatite. Okay, so this is the upper group one chromatite layer. Okay, so I'll go through all the some of the features that we had an opportunity to see during the field trip. So one of them was a bifurcation of the chromatite layers. So if you look at this layer here, going in this direction to the right, you have this layer splitting into two. So this is what it's called bifurcation. We also have we saw anorthosite lenses, anorthosite inclusions inside the chromatite layers. So at some places we saw irregular clust of anorthosite, and at some places we saw a lenticular elongated inclusions of anorthosite. So we also saw layers of anorthosite with upper planar contact and lower wavy contact. So here we have a disturbed critical thin layers of chromatite layers. So we also have features like this, which could resemble a transport. You could imagine this glass being transported in this way and leaving a tail. That's just an interpretation. So we also have thin layers of chromatites going into the clast of anorthosite. And we also have disturbed thin layers of chromatites. And if you look closely here, we have OPX oikocrysts. So this OPX oikocrysts grew over the deformation. So it was post deformation. So these are the spectacular exposure of the chromatite layers. So we also have a place where we have an anorthosite dome-like structure. And if you look at this chromatite clast, they look very angular. So this is this was probably a result of brittle deformation. So I remember we had a huge disagreement around this place, discussing the origin of these layers. Okay, so now I'll go through the igneous layering models, the popular ones. There are so many models. I'll only go through the popular ones. So we have one as gravitational settling and sorting. So this is where you can have a magma chamber and crystallization in a magma chamber of maybe different crystals differing in size or density. Then because of differences in density and size, they'll settle at different rates. So you get sorting and that's you get layering from there. You can get changes in the oxygen conditions in the magma. So this can cause a shift in the phase boundary. So you can shift the phase boundary in such a way that you end up in a chromatite only stability fault. Same thing with pressure change. Changes in pressure can also cause a shift in stability fault. We have also in situ crystallization, where you can have crystallization along the margins of the magma chamber. Another model, which is the most favored, it's magma mixing. So here, if you look at this diagram, if you start with the magma with this composition and it evolves along this path, you end up maybe here or here. Then you have another pulse of magma, then the evolved magma and the primitive magma mixes creates a composite which can land you in this stability field where you have a saturation of chromite. So the most one of the most mysterious features of these layers are the bifurcation. So I'll go through some of the models that attempts to explain the origin of the bifurcations. We have a depositional model, intrusive model, and a deformational model. One model was by Calthorn. So here we are in the magma chamber. We start with a wavy floor. A wavy floor, then we have crystallization and settling of chromatites. We form thin layers of chromatites. Then move to here, we have in situ growth of anorthosite, filling these depressions here. And we have another episode of crystallization and settling of chromatite. Another model was by Polnex. Here we start with a straight base, bottom of the magma chamber. Then we have crystallization and settling of chromatite. From there, we have unstable, we have some instability, and then we have anorthosite marsh rising, disturbing the thin chromatite layers. You can see here, they break the layers. From there, you have anorthosite over the chromatite layers. And then you have the next episode of chromatite crystallization and settling. Another one was by Lee. So here, same thing, crystallization and settling. So you have a concentration of chromatite crystals at the bottom of the magma chamber, and you have fractures that developed beneath the magma chamber. So from there you have flow of this chromatite-rich magma or slurries into these fractures. Then you result with these features resembling bifurcations. We have a model by Calthorne. Calthorne came back in 2015. So again, with a wavy base, we start with a plagiate clay suspended in the magma, and then from there we have some kind of shock which induces crystallization of chromatite. So we have a thin layer of chromatite. From there we have some of the plagiate clays in the magma chamber settling, filling the depressions again, and so another shock which induces another episode of chromatite crystallization and settling. Another model by Vordu. Apologies if I pronounce the surname wrong. Okay, so here we start with fractures in the anorthosite. Then from there we have a slurry of chromatite. So it flows along the fractures, it fills the fractures, and then when it solidifies, it forms the bifurcation structures. Another one was by Mukeji. So here we have fractures developing at the bottom of the magma chamber, and magma flowing in this way. And then we have crystallization of chromatites, and also some of the chromatite-rich liquid flowing through these channels, and solidifications resulting in these structures. Another model, we have alternating layer of chromatite and anorthosite. So we have here also we have a diaporism. So we have anorthosite plumes also rising here, and then disturbing these chromatite layers. So this one is pushed onto the first one. The second layer is pushed onto the second one. The second one is pushed onto the first one. So resulting in what looks like lenses of anorthosite and resembling bifurcations. Kuligano will take over from here.
Afternoon. Okay, on the tent we went to a pressure pipe. So this is an iron-rich pipe. So what we saw there is that we have round fragments of different sizes. The majority of those fragments were the norite anorthosite, and some of were pyroxenite and moted anorthosite. And the host rock of this pipe is a moted anorthosite. So the majority of these fragments, the norite and anorthosite, are the rocks that we saw in the critical zone. So from what I'm seeing, my conclusion is that this pipe was going up, not like the Downer model that has been suggested. So the other thing, the interstitial material, is the iron-rich ultramafic material. That is a sharp contact with the host rock, the moted anorthosite. The other features that we saw is that at the base, we have triple junctions of these round fragments or angular fragments now. But at the top, we have the rounded elongate that are showing preferred orientation. And what I can suggest from this is that maybe these fragments at the bottom, they formed the triple junctions because of congestion, because we were close to the roof here. So when they started piling up, they formed these triple junctions, and these ones were not forming those triple junctions. So the following day, we went to magnetize to see the, so we moved from the upper critical zone to the upper zone of the push belt. So we're at this location, the magnetites. So the upper zone of the push belt is divided into three subdivisions, the upper zone subdivision A, B, and C. So we're at this area, the upper zone A. So along the road, we saw the altered craponorites or crapoic rocks. And then we went down to the river to observe the magnetites. Walking down, we saw that these magnetite layers were varying in thicknesses, and also in the we saw the common textures that they have sharp basal contacts and gradational upper contacts. As you move up, or you see that there's an increase in the abundance of the plagioclase sands, and in some areas you only have massive magnetites. And this is one magnetite layer that I came across that is over 1 meter. So also sat down and also started discussing the models and using what we have observed in the field. One of the models that came up was the change in oxygen vacancy, that if you increase oxygen vacancy, you favor the crystallization of magnetites, but it also decreases the partitioning of the vanadium, I mean the magnetites. And there's also a change in pressure that has been mentioned by Muriel, that if you increase pressure, that will affect the boundaries of the phases, and you might end up in the stability field of the magnetites, crystallizing the massive magnetites. There's also magma mixing model, where they're saying there could be an injection of new magma at the level of the oxide layers. When they study the PGE distribution at the massive, at the main magnetite layer, they saw that there was a difference below the main MML and the PGE distribution above the MML. There's also liquid immiscibility. In 2016, they showed that there's the apatite grains in the upper zone subdivision C, where the upper zone, the apatite grains are hosting coexisting silica and iron-rich immiscible inclusions. And there's also gravitational settling and sorting, and there's another one, the in-situ crystallization of the magnetites. The other model that has come up is that there could be pulses of new magma that is rich in plagioclase crystals. So that's why maybe you are missing the paroxysms moving from the magnetite into the anorthosites. So that's why you're missing the paroxysms. So with these oxide layers, they are mining vanadium. This map is from the Bushveld Minerals website. So right now they're mining at the northern limb and the vermiculite breeds. They are mining the vanadium. The average grade is 1.75%. And in future, we could be mining extracting titanium, which is being extracted from the Richards Bay deposits. Yeah, thank you.
I will take you through the mine visits. We went to Kusasaletu gold mine visit, and then the location is at Kusasaletu in Carltonville, which is located about 90 kilometers west of Johannesburg. Regionally, it is located on the Witwatersrand Rand Basin on the Klapveld Craton. The mining is conducted on the VCR, which is the Ventersdorp contact drift. It is overlain by the Ventersdorp lovers of the Ventersdorp supergroup. The drift itself is a narrow tabular ore body and the reef is comprised of quartz pebble conglomerates hosting gold with pyrite mineralization. Unfortunately, we didn't see the gold, we saw the pyrite. So the geological map here just shows the gold-bearing units of the Witwatersrand Basin and the older sedimentary rocks. So this is a cross-section of the Kusasole 2 Fantastop contact drift. This just shows you where the mineral resources are. They're measured, indicated, and inferred right here. So this is important when they have to look at gold grade of the mine itself. So the mine consists of two shafts, the twin vertical and twin sub-vertical shaft systems that are used to locate the deeper parts of the mine. They use sequential grid mining method, wherein they put regional stabilizing pillars, the backfill bolts and clamping pillars. These are used to support the geological structures that they might find underground. So the mining is done at a depth of about 3.38 kilometers, but the mine itself goes down to 3.75. So the average grade of the gold at Kusasale 2 is between 6 to 12 grams per ton. This includes the measured, inferred, and the indicated. So this is just a picture of the miners underground, the Kusasale 2. Unfortunately, we were not able to take a picture because of illegal miners, Zamazamas, you see. So Lemu will take you through the diamond visit.
Hello, everyone. So the Cullinan Diamond Mine is situated in the Gauteng province, 40 kilometers to the east of Pretoria. And this mine was previously owned by De Beers, and it was sold to Petra Diamonds in 2008. This mine is well renowned for its nitrogen-free and boron-bearing blue diamonds. And it has estimated reserves of up to 192 megacarats, and it has envisioned resource level of around 1,000 meters, and the current mining level is at 880 meters. So the expected life of mine is about 50 years. So the kimberlite pipe at the Cullinan Diamond Mine is carrot shaped in cross section and P-shaped in plan view, and the shape of the carrot of the kimberlite decreases at 7% every 100 meters. So the kimberlite pipe intruded the Transvaal supergroup and the Bushveld, and it was later intruded by the gabbrosil of the Bushveld. There are two main categories of kimberlite in the Cullinan mine. There's the volcanoclastic kimberlite category and the hyperbasal category of kimberlite. And the volcanoclastic kimberlite category includes the brown kimberlite and the grain kimberlite, while the hyperbasal kimberlite category includes the piebald. There's a pale piebald and the dark piebald, and also a black coherent kimberlite. So the hyperbasal kimberlites have the highest quality diamonds, and the brown and gray kimberlites have the lowest quality diamonds, and they also have the most waste because they are part of the kimberlite event that intruded first, so they have the most entrainment. So this is samples from the mine that show only three of the kimberlite samples, this doesn't include the piebald kimberlite, it only includes the black, gray, and brown kimberlite, and this is how they look in sample. So the factors influencing the mining methods used at this Cullinan Diamond Mine is the cost of the actual method, the grade of the ore, and geotechnical parameters sorry for the spelling, geotechnical parameters that are considered. So they use sub-level and block cave mining methods. And for the sub-level method, the wall rock is drilled, charged, and blasted, and about 80% of the ground is collected. And this process continues every 2 meters. And this method is more expensive than the block cave method, which is implemented by choosing a block that's about 100 to 200 meters and only undercutting or drilling and blasting only 15 meters of the lower part of the block and letting the upper lying material to collapse under their own gravity. So the block cave method is very expensive to implement, but once it's up and running, it's really cheap compared to the sub-level cave method. So the processing at the Cullinan mine, they process both their tailings and production from their primary ore. So this is fed into the silos where they await to go into the actual plant, where they are milled by autogenous milling, that is, they're milled by attrition, where the rocks just bump into one another and break each other. So from there, they go into the screening phase, where diamonds that are less than 1 millimeter are discarded to the slime dams because they are below the cutoff grade. And blocks of rock that are more than 75 millimeters are returned back to the silo where they'll be recrushed in the high pressure grinding rolls. So if the diamonds happen to be above 1.15 millimeters, which is the cutoff grade at the Cullinan mine, they are fed into the diamond recovery sections. Depending on how big the diamond is, it will be led into the large recovery or medium fine recovery sections. And from there, these diamonds are led into the final recovery where they'll be cut. So with all of that said, we didn't only learn nice things in this field trip. We also have evidence that we had a lot of fun in this field trip. That's our evidence. Very fun trip.